The peeling white paint and creaking floorboards were telltale signs that the old farmhouse had seen better days. But to me, it was perfect. After months of agonizing over the decision, I finally committed to moving across the country from Portland to rural Virginia. As much as it pained me to leave my friends and job behind after my grandfather's passing, someone needed to take care of his farm. Despite our distance, Gramps and I always had a special bond growing up. I have fond memories of visiting him during the summers as a kid, learning to ride horses, make homemade jam, and gaze at the endless blankets of stars that speckled the night sky. The 300-acre Blue Hills farm was in our family for 5 generations. Gramps took over the property when my great-grandfather retired and devoted his life to cultivating the land. He loved every grove of trees, every spring-fed creek that cut through the fields, every barn and fence post, even that old crumbling farmhouse. That's why it crushed me when he said the doctor wanted him to move into assisted living in town. He swore he'd find a way to get back home to Blue Hills someday. But the months turned into years. His health declined, and he never made it home. After he passed, I couldn't bear the thought of selling the old farm to strangers when it meant so much to him. The property deserved a new chapter, not demolition. Hence my cross-country move from urban Portland to rural Rappahannock County, Virginia. As I crested the last hill, a wave of nostalgia washed over me at the "Welcome to Blue Hills Farm" sign that still stood tall. The 2-story white clapboard farmhouse rested on a high point overlooking the patchworks of barren winter fields. A long gravel driveway, lined with mature pin oaks, led up to the wraparound porch. I pictured Gramps sitting in his rocking chair there, waving as I arrived for the summer. Dragging my suitcases up the front steps, I got the jitters. What did I really know about tending a farm by myself? The enormity of the task hit all at once. Unlocking the etched glass door, I stepped into the foyer. A fine layer of dust that blurred the quaint floral wallpaper revealed no one had lived here for quite some time. The air smelled of worn leather and smoked cherry tobacco, the remnants of Gramps' presence. I strolled through the cozy living room and dining area, running my fingers over the antique furniture, frosted window panes, and ornate rugs that Gramps said were centuries old when he was a boy. In the kitchen, faded yellow wallpaper peeled around an old cast-iron stove and floor-to-ceiling cabinets. The sink was dry and rusty. Making this place livable again would be a big job. I sighed, moving on to explore the bedrooms and bath upstairs. The old iron bedsteads and vanities, more floral wallpaper, a bookshelf filled with well-worn Louis L'Amour paperbacks. This place was truly stuck in time. My only addition for now was setting up Gramps' mahogany roll-top desk in the corner bedroom I chose as my own, my work-from-home base, while in Virginia. Through every warped window pane, I gazed out at the farm's endless hills and meadows. How I loved this place already. I pictured the orchards blossoming pink and white in spring, hills rolling with amber waves of grain in summer, the blazing technicolor canopy of hardwoods in fall. This is where I was meant to be. After the long drive, I was starving. Unpacking could wait until tomorrow. I headed out to the back porch to fire up the grill when I noticed the storm cellar doors. In an instant, Gramps' weathered voice flooded my mind with the stern warning he recited every summer of my childhood. "Now, don't you ever, ever go messing around that old storm cellar, you hear?" When I'd ask why, his eyes would darken and he'd grumble, "Just never you mind. There's things best left untouched." A chill ran down my spine, remembering the hardness in his voice. I stared at the rusty padlock and doors patched with creeping moss and wondered what secrets lay below. Shaking off a lurking unease, I fired up the grill and dug into my first Blue Hills Farm steak dinner. The future here suddenly seemed bright and full of promise. As the sun dipped below the silhouetted tree line, I felt at peace. I had made it. Gramps would be so proud. Tomorrow, a new chapter begins. It was my first night staying in Grandpa's old farmhouse after he passed away. I had always loved visiting here as a kid, but now, being here alone, it felt eerie. As I lay in bed missing Grandpa something awful, I was just drifting off around midnight when I woke with goosebumps. From somewhere outside, I could hear these strange, muffled cries, like somebody weeping. At first, I thought I was dreaming, but then it came again, desperate, wailing cries that gave me the chills. I checked that all the doors were locked up tight before crawling back under the sheets, but I couldn't relax, listening close for the cries as my sleepy brain imagined all sorts of spooky stuff. Just as I finally calmed myself enough to doze off, the cries started up again, even louder than before. I fumbled for the flashlight Grandpa always kept in the bedside drawer. Gripping that heavy metal flashlight made me feel braver as I crept to peer out each window into the dark yard. Outside was pitch black and silent, with no sign of anything. I stepped out onto the creaky porch in my bare feet, sweeping the flashlight beam around the yard and surrounding fields. As I came around the back of the house, the cries started up again from somewhere nearby, louder than ever. My heart raced as I realized the sound was coming from Grandpa's old storm cellar. The wooden doors were rattling as another scream rose up from the blackness below. Part of me wanted to rush over, convinced something or someone was trapped down there and needed help. But in the flashlight's beam, I could see the cellar doors were chained and padlocked shut tight. Looking closer, I could just make out a sliver of inky blackness through the cracks between the old gray boards. But it was impossible to see inside, and the cries had stopped again just as sudden as they started. I quickly checked the outside of the whole house, looking for any signs of intruders playing a mean prank on the new owner. But there was no movement, no clues left behind. Everything seemed normal on this still, dark night, except for those desperate, wailing cries echoing in my mind. I just couldn't shake the feeling that something was trapped in that cellar, desperate for help. But why had Grandpa kept it locked and forbidden me from going near it? None of it made any sense. Exhausted, but too spooked to sleep, I spent the next day phoning my best friend Alex, the closest thing I had to family these days. After pouring my heart out about missing Grandpa and describing the weird crying sounds, Alex gently suggested it could be my imagination, or some animal noises that my grief-stricken mind had exaggerated. He kindly offered to drive out and stay with me until the funeral arrangements were finalized. Having a friend there would mean so much, but I didn't want to inconvenience Alex or come off as crazy. I insisted I was fine alone, but made him promise to come out soon for a long overdue visit. I busied myself that day with going through Grandpa's things and making funeral plans, trying not to glance out at that cellar every few minutes. With the sunshine bathing the farmhouse, it was hard to believe those desperate cries even happened. Just a fox or stray cat trapped briefly down there, I told myself. But when night fell, my fears came creeping back in. I found myself jumping at every little creak and pop of that old house settling. Determined not to be so spooked, I searched Grandpa's study to see if I could find any clues about that cellar. If it was just for storing vegetables or equipment, why had he been so adamant about me never going near it? But after combing through the clutter of books and papers, I found nothing about the history of the cellar or farm. Grandpa had taken all those secrets to the grave. The only thing that gave me some comfort was making an entire pot of coffee that evening. I sat sipping the hot, bitter drink at the kitchen table as I watched the sunset through the window above the sink. The caffeine helped shake me from my drowsy fears as I resolved to stay awake all night, listening for those cries again. I had to know if they were real or just my imagination, so I could decide what to do next. Gripping my flashlight, I settled into the creaky wicker chair on the back porch to stand guard through the long night ahead. An owl hooted its lonely call in the distance as the last faint glow disappeared over the cornfields. It was just me and the coming darkness now. As the night wore on, I strained my ears listening for any odd sounds from my perch on the back porch. I sipped cup after cup of bitter black coffee, fighting against my growing drowsiness. The empty, inky void of the cornfields and the lonely hoots of owls set my nerves on edge. I must have dozed off around 2 a.m. because I jerked awake and sloshed cold coffee over myself. Disoriented, it took me a moment to remember why I was outside in the wicker chair. Then I heard it, the faint but unmistakable cries drifting up from the storm cellar once again. Gripping my flashlight, I leapt up and stumbled through the overgrown grass around to the cellar doors. The cries were louder and more anguished than ever, interspersed with odd thumping sounds against the wooden doors. This was no animal. It sounded like a person down there. Frantically, I searched for some way to open the doors, but they remained chained and padlocked. I shouted down, "Hold on, I'm going to get you out." But the cries only intensified until they dissolved into whimpers. Soon, an eerie silence returned, leaving me shaken. I swept the flashlight beam over every inch of the doors, even using a rake to prod into the weeds around the cellar entrance. But there was no secret latch or loose board, no way anything larger than a rat could have gotten in. Had I imagined it all? Exhausted and confused, I sat with my back against the cold cellar doors as the eastern sky lightened with dawn's approach. Either someone was trapped down there each night, or I was losing my mind. I thought of Grandpa refusing to speak of the cellar all these years. What secrets had he kept? Then, for the third night in a row, I was jolted awake by the strange crying sounds coming from Grandpa's storm cellar again. Even with my bedroom window shut up tight and locked, the anguished wails still drifted through the glass, barely muffled. I lay huddled beneath my old homemade quilt, trembling as each new sob arose from the darkness outside. The cries sounded like a woman, her voice raw from weeping, interspersed with soft whimpers that twisted my heart. What tormented soul was making these mournful cries outside each night? My increasing exhaustion left me feeling totally disoriented and filled with dread as I strained to listen. I couldn't make out any clear words, only pained moans that seemed to increase in intensity as the hours dragged on. I glanced at the bedside clock, 3:17 a.m. The red numbers glowed ominously in the dark room. I considered trying to drown out the noise with my headphones, but knew sleep would be impossible. The anguished cries seeped into my brain, conjuring vivid images to accompany each wail. I pictured a skeletal woman in a tattered white gown, her face obscured by long dark hair, clawing desperately at the storm cellar doors with bloody fingernails. Shuddering, I pulled the covers over my head, but it did little to blunt the sounds. Only the approach of dawn finally brought some relief around 5:30 a.m. as the cries faded back into silence. Exhausted, I knew I couldn't endure another night like this. If I had to face another onslaught of those wrenching sobs, I felt certain it would drive me over the edge of sanity. When the first dim rays of sunlight crept into my bedroom at dawn, I knew I had to get to the bottom of this today, no matter what it took. The lack of sleep was already making me feel like a jittery mess, unable to concentrate or function properly. I needed answers before I unraveled completely. I got dressed sluggishly, my limbs heavy and my head throbbing. Despite my fatigue, determination propelled me forward. Gripping a steaming cup of black coffee, I headed out into the chilly morning air towards the storm cellar as the sun peaked above the horizon. The grass was soaked with dew, dampening the hems of my jeans as I made my way across the lawn. Approaching the wooden doors now bathed in sunlight, I half expected to find the chain and padlock spontaneously broken, the doors standing wide open to reveal some grisly secret. But there they remained, still securely fastened, just as I had left them the night before. Setting down my coffee, I grasped the cold metal lock in one hand and gave it a hard rattle, as if trying to startle whatever was on the other side. But the only response was the hollow clanging of the chain against the wooden boards. Shining my flashlight along each crack and seam, I searched intently for any opening or gap that something, or someone, could possibly squeeze through. But the only gaps I found were the natural separations between the weathered slats, far too narrow even for the tiniest animal. I pounded my fist on the doors in frustration, releasing clouds of dust that had probably accumulated for decades undisturbed in the abandoned cellar. The sound reverberated deeply below, but provided no clues besides confirming this was a large, empty space. Turning away with a resigned sigh, I tried to gather my tangled thoughts in shaking hands before they spilled my coffee. There had to be something I was missing, some detail or knowledge that would make sense of these disturbing events. I just needed to keep searching. By late afternoon, I was bleary-eyed, yet consumed with solving the mystery of the cries from the storm cellar. I gathered every tool I could find in Grandpa's dusty tool shed, hammers, chisels, crowbars, and more. With all my might, I attacked the rusty padlock and heavy chains coiled around the cellar doors, but after hours of pounding, prying, and scraping at it, I made no progress at all. Out of breath, my hands blistered and trembling, I finally collapsed in the grass and screamed out loud in frustration and defeat. This padlock was never going to budge, and those desperate cries were going to haunt me forever if I couldn't find some way to get inside and discover the source. Exhausted and desperate, I decided a last resort would be to drive into town and try to get someone, anyone, to help me break into that cellar. My old pickup truck sputtered and rattled as I sped down the country back roads past cornfields glowing gold in the sunset light. Arriving in town just as shops were closing up, I went straight to Doc Jenkins' small office attached to his house. If anyone knew secrets about Grandpa's farm, it would be Doc, who had treated our family for over 40 years. I parked sloppily and jogged up to pound on his front door, startling the old man. "Well, hey there, you must be John's grandson. I heard you were back in town. Come on in, come in," Doc Jenkins said, ushering me inside. I sat stiffly on a faded floral sofa cluttered with crocheted pillows. "Doc, I really need your help with something. Strange things have been happening out at the farm since Grandpa died," I started. "Oh, sure, I bet it's hard being out there alone. All those memories coming back," he replied gently. I described the crying sounds from the storm cellar in detail, but Doc just nodded along with a patronizing smile, like I was a boy claiming monsters under my bed. "Now, son, I know it's been a rough transition, but those are likely just some stray dogs or other critters that wandered onto the property. Nothing to get yourself worked up about." He patted my shoulder with his wrinkled hand. I stammered a frustrated objection, but Doc waved it off. "You just need some time to settle in. Here, I'll give you a few raccoon traps to put your mind at ease. You'll have this sorted out in no time." Seeing I was getting nowhere with the dismissive old doctor, I got up to leave, politely refusing the offer of stale cookies from his wife. My only other hope was the sheriff, though I had little faith he'd react differently. I drove to the small sheriff's station as they were locking up for the night. The overweight sheriff eyed me warily, probably already guessing why the new stranger was visiting. I sat in the rickety chair across from his desk, cluttered with donut crumbs, and tried to calmly, rationally describe the wailing cries and my need to get into that cellar. But Sheriff Bigby's response was infuriatingly similar to Doc Jenkins. "Son, you city folks just aren't used to quiet country living. All kinds of critters make noises at night. I'm sure it's nothing to get all worked up about," he chuckled condescendingly. I pleaded urgently for them to at least come listen themselves or help me break open the padlock, but the sheriff just laughed again. "Can't go around destroying property on a hunch. You're letting this old house spook you. Tell you what, I'll swing by and check the outside whenever I'm patrolling that way. But don't go causing any trouble now. Your grandfather was a well-liked man in these parts." Disappointed, I left the sheriff's station as he switched off the lights, leaving me alone in the dark parking lot with only my unreliable truck for company. Clearly, no one in town wanted to dig up whatever secrets Grandpa left buried in his past. I would get no help from them. After another dismissive encounter with the sheriff, I left the station disheartened but not ready to surrender. As I drove down Main Street past the sleepy shops closing up for the evening, one last idea came to me. Old Mr. Clark, who ran the town's hardware store. He had known Grandpa for ages and was always happy to help folks in need. If anyone might believe me and lend a hand, it would be kind Mr. Clark. I parked my truck across the street and hurried over to the hardware store, just as Mr. Clark was locking up for the night. Cupping my hands against the glass door, I peered inside searching for him in the cluttered, dimly lit shop. Finally, I spotted him emerging from a back room, lugging a toolbox. Tapping on the glass, I waved to get his attention. Mr. Clark squinted through his thick glasses, and then a look of recognition crossed his face. Unlocking the door again, he greeted me warmly. "Well, if it isn't John's grandson, I heard you were back in town. Come in, come in." I smiled with relief as I stepped inside, breathing in the familiar scents of sawdust and motor oil. If anyone would hear me out, it was Mr. Clark. He led me back to his cramped office, overflowing with invoices and parts catalogs. Clearing a stack of papers off a metal chair, he motioned for me to sit down while he settled in behind the cluttered desk. "Now, tell me, what brings you by this evening, son?" Mr. Clark asked, peering at me intently. I cleared my throat, trying to figure out where to begin. I started hesitantly recounting my experiences in the farmhouse, especially the crying from the storm cellar. Mr. Clark listened thoughtfully, never interrupting, as I described lying awake trembling, pounding on the locked cellar doors. "So, you see, I'm at my wit's end trying to solve this mystery," I concluded. I wish I could ask Grandpa about it, but he's gone. The doctor and sheriff don't believe me. You knew Grandpa? Do you think I'm crazy? Or could he have been hiding something out there? I held my breath, awaiting Mr. Clark's response. At first, he was silent, drumming his wrinkled fingers on the table. Then he looked directly into my eyes. John was one of the finest men I've ever known, but even the best among us have secrets we'd rather stay buried, he said sagely. I exhaled an immense relief. Someone finally believed me. I wanted to embrace the kind Mr. Clark right then and there. I trust John's grandson, and I aim to help if I can, he continued. Gripping his cane, he slowly rose to his feet. Let me take a look around the inventory. I bet we can find you something useful. I followed him through the shadowy aisles, crammed floor to ceiling with tools and parts, ducking under dangling cords and exposed rafters. Mr. Clark surveyed the shelves, mumbling to himself and consulting his memory. He paused before a section of heavy metal tools. There we are, he proclaimed. Reaching up to a top shelf, he retrieved an enormous set of bolt cutters. They must have weighed 15 pounds at least. Grunting with effort, he handed them over to me. I nearly dropped them, fumbling for a grip on the cold cast iron. My heaviest duty set, he declared proudly. If those chains can resist this monster, they deserve to stay on. He chuckled and gave me an encouraging pat on the back that nearly sent me toppling forward. I don't know how to thank you for this, I said earnestly. Mr. Clark waved it off. Just let me know what you find. These old ears love a good mystery. He promised to keep this just between us. Gripping the bolt cutters under my arm, I set out into the night. Driving home as the sun set, I felt strengthened, knowing someone finally believed me. I had the right tools now. All that remained was braving the contents of that cellar. For hours, I practiced using the giant, heavy bolt cutters on scraps of rusted metal and solid branches. As I worked, my mind raced nervously with what I might find once inside. Would it reveal some dark chapter of Grandpa's past? Or maybe a drifter had broken in and was hiding there? The more I speculated, the more anxious I became. Finally, with the moon suspended high above the farmhouse, it was time. Gripping the heavy cutters under one arm, I took a deep breath to steady my nerves. Then I marched resolutely across the lawn, still sparkling with dew, towards the looming storm cellar. The full moon illuminated my path in an eerie bluish glow. Setting down my flashlight, I positioned the bolt cutters onto one of the thick, rusty links. I stood on the handles, using my full body weight to squeeze the handles with all my strength. The cutters clamped down powerfully, biting into the aged metal. For several tense moments, I strained against the resisting link, until suddenly it burst apart. I very nearly tumbled backward down the grassy slope from the force, but I'd done it. The severed link left a gap just wide enough to thread the chain free of the cellar doors. After silently cheering this small victory, I braced myself to continue. Gripping the flashlight, I creaked open one warped wooden door. A rush of stale, damp air escaped into the night, along with the overpowering odors of mildew and decay. I braced for something to come lurching out from that darkness, but there was only silence below. Sweeping my flashlight beam down the stairs, I revealed damp earth walls and rickety wooden steps disappearing into the dark. Far below, my light faintly illuminated a dirt floor before the darkness swallowed it. Descending slowly, each step sagged and groaned under my weight. The farther I went, the colder and more unsettled I felt. This was a mistake. I never should have come down here, I thought, just as frantic skittering sounded below me. I cried out in alarm as several rats, disturbed by my encroaching light, came racing up the rotten steps past me seeking escape. Shuddering with disgust, I readied my weakening nerves. I had come too far to turn back now. After what seemed an eternity, I reached the dirt floor, sending up puffs of dust with each step. My flashlight revealed only dirt, cobwebs, and scurrying cockroaches. The musty smell down here made me gag. As I slowly turned in a circle, searching for anything unusual, my light fell upon some lumpy shadows in the far corner. I cautiously moved nearer, half expecting a corpse or a grotesque creature to emerge from the dark, but as I drew closer, the shape resolved into an old, mildew-stained cot sitting in the dirt, like a bedroll you'd take camping. Strange. Looked like someone had been sleeping down here for a while, but the mattress was caved in and moth-eaten, clearly abandoned long ago. Still, it gave me the creeps thinking of someone holing up in this cold, dirty cellar. Why would anyone want to stay down here? I swung the flashlight slowly around the rest of the cellar again. Empty shelves, some old tools and jars, not much else. Seemed like a pretty normal, if creepy, bare bones kind of cellar. I felt a rush of relief it wasn't hiding anything too unusual after all. Still, I was mighty confused about how those crying sounds had been coming from this dusty old space. It was like the sobs just echoed out of thin air. Over in one corner, my light shone on a pile of tattered old clothes. Looked like men's work shirts and pants, though it was hard to tell with them so torn up and stained. I poked through the pile with my foot, but nothing seemed strange about them. Must have been leftover clothes or rags from the farm. Just as I was about to head back upstairs, I heard a loud creak directly above me. I froze, imagining someone in the house, about to discover me snooping around the cellar. Moving quick, I rushed up the rickety stairs and eased the cellar door shut as quietly as I could. Heart pounding, I crept around to the side of the house and grabbed a rake from the shed to use as protection. Cautiously as can be, I checked every room and closet inside the farmhouse, looking for any signs of an intruder. Checked all the doors and windows too, locked up tight as I left them. The creaky floorboards settled, and I started to feel foolish for getting so jumpy over nothing. After thoroughly checking the whole property again and finding nada out of place, I convinced myself it was just the wind or an old house sound that had startled me. With my nerve shot, it was no wonder I got spooked. But it sure didn't help me solve the real mystery of where those sad cries had come from in the first place. I knew I wasn't just hearing things. The proof was down there somehow, if I could piece it all together. Exhausted as I was, I couldn't rest just yet. I decided to make some coffee and try looking through Grandpa's things again to see if I could find any shred of a clue about his storm cellar. There had to be something that would help me figure this out. With my nerves still on edge, I hurried back inside the farmhouse and went straight to the kitchen to brew a fresh pot of strong coffee. I had a long night of searching ahead if I was going to find any clues in Grandpa's belongings that could shed light on the history of that cellar. As the coffee brewed, the rich aroma calmed my jittery senses, but my mind continued racing, trying to make sense of it all. Those desperate cries had seemed so real in the nights before. How could they seemingly vanish into thin air? And what was the meaning of that abandoned cot hidden down below? Pouring myself a steaming mug, I carried it carefully upstairs towards Grandpa's bedroom. If answers existed anywhere, they would be among his personal effects. Settling onto the floor amidst the dusty boxes and trunks I had started sorting through earlier, I sipped the hot coffee gratefully and tried to clear my mind. Methodically, I began combing through each stack of old books and papers, searching for any references to the farmhouse's past owners or strange occurrences. 2 hours passed fruitlessly, with nothing noteworthy found besides old bank statements and appliance manuals. Discouraged, I sank back against the bed with a sigh. Just then, my gaze landed on the battered metal lockbox tucked halfway under the bed that I had overlooked before. Dragging it out, I retrieved the key from the bedside drawer and opened the creaky lid. Inside sat just a jumble of yellowed papers, but my pulse quickened. Gently removing each document, I scanned for anything significant. Most seemed to be old property records or letter exchanges about crop rotations. But near the bottom of the pile, a newspaper headline leaped out at me. Migrant worker still missing after 2 weeks. Hands trembling with anticipation, I unfolded the fragile paper dated 1957. The article detailed the suspicious disappearance of a man named Joseph Garcia, who was passing through the area as a farmhand. He went missing after last being seen near Grandpa's property. Despite search efforts, the migrant's whereabouts were never discovered. Could this be linked to the eerie cries from the cellar? Had Grandpa known more than he let on about Joseph Garcia's fate? My mind flooded with dark speculations, but I tried to stay rational. The next morning, I headed into town with renewed energy to ask around about that mysterious, missing migrant worker, Joseph Garcia. Someone around here must remember the case and provide insights I couldn't learn from the short newspaper clip alone. My first stop was the hardware store to speak with kindly Mr. Clark. As he rang up a customer's order, I casually brought up the disappearance. Mr. Clark's expression turned solemn. "Ah, yes, I recall that incident. Terrible thing," he said, adjusting his glasses. He went on to explain that Joseph was a young Latino man hired for seasonal work, harvesting crops on farms around the county. One summer, he worked over at the property next to Grandpa's, but then that fall, he suddenly vanished without collecting his wages. "Search parties were sent out for days on end but turned up nothing," Mr. Clark continued, shaking his head. "In the end, the police chalked it up to the migrant lifestyle, figured he moved on with the seasons as they do. But something about it never sat right with me. A man doesn't just disappear." I nodded eagerly, hanging on Mr. Clark's every word. This matched bits I learned from the newspaper, but his perspective painted a clearer picture. After thanking Mr. Clark profusely for the information, I was bursting to continue following this trail. My next stops were the public library archives again and the small newspaper office to comb through their records of missing persons going back years. It was tedious work scrolling through microfiche and yellowed back issues, but finally, I was certain of two things. One, no other unexplained disappearances similar to Joseph's had occurred in the area since 1957 that I could find. And two, there were zero mentions of anyone reporting strange cries like I'd been hearing recently. Whatever was causing those anguished nightly wails seemed unique to my experiences. Satisfied I had exhaustively checked the records, I visited the hardware store once more to purchase a motion-activated trail camera. If I could stake out the cellar all night, any movements or sounds should be captured on film. No more guessing if my mind was playing tricks. Arriving back at the farm well before sunset, I mounted the camera on a fence post facing the cellar doors in the distance. After double-checking the motion sensor worked, I felt confident I could finally get concrete evidence tonight. As darkness fell, instead of dread, I now felt prepared and determined. A good meal and restful sleep would grant me the energy to face whatever this night exposed. My time living in fear and doubt was over. Tonight may provide answers about Joseph Garcia and the cause of the cries. I double-checked the camera and settled in early, determined to be alert. Around midnight, I was startled awake by the beeping alert coming from the camera outside. Yes, it must have detected movement. Fumbling for a flashlight, I rushed outside into the chilly night air, my bare feet soaked from the dewy grass. Reaching the camera, I eagerly scrolled through the footage. The first clip showed the cellar doors rattling faintly in the wind. My heart raced as I watched clip after clip, sure that something would appear. But as I scanned through the footage of the empty yard, my excitement drained away. There was nothing unusual at all, just stray dogs wandering by, causing the motion sensor to activate. I listened closely, but couldn't hear any wailing cries in real time either. Feeling defeated, I deleted the footage and trudged back inside to try getting a bit more shut-eye. But sleep evaded me as I lay restlessly in bed, listening to the occasional soft cries still drifting from the cellar on the breeze. Why had the camera captured nothing? I wanted to believe I wasn't crazy and that the solution to this mystery was within my grasp, but I couldn't silence the discouraging thought that perhaps I had imagined it all. When morning sunlight finally filtered into my room, I felt no closer to answers. However, a nagging feeling in my gut told me there was still something unexplained about all this. Enough coincidences had piled up that couldn't be mere chance. The empty cot in the cellar, as if someone had been staying there. The pile of worn clothes that didn't match Grandpa's style. The migrant worker who disappeared nearby so long ago. And most of all, those mournful cries piercing the night. Too many signs indicated Grandpa knew more than he told me about this land's history. What had happened here that he felt compelled to take to his grave? I found myself wishing for the 100th time that he was still alive so I could ask him directly. After another mostly sleepless night, still haunted by the faint cries from the storm cellar, I decided to clean out and organize Grandpa's bedroom to occupy myself. He had accumulated so much clutter over the years that I kept finding items buried under piles of books and papers. While clearing out his closet, I uncovered several old shoeboxes stuffed haphazardly on the top shelf. Bringing them down, I found that they contained just more paperwork and receipts. I was about to move on when I spotted a tattered leather journal wedged at the back of the closet's top shelf. Retrieving it, I saw a date from 40 years prior written on the cover. Grandpa must have kept some kind of personal diary or logbook. Moving to sit on the edge of his creaky bed, I handled the journal delicately given its age as I opened to the first yellowed page. The elegant cursive detailed Grandpa's daily farm work, the weather, crop yields, mundane stuff. But as I gently turned each page, an entry from a few decades ago made my heart skip a beat. Grandpa described waking to the same crying noises outside at night that I had been experiencing. He wrote of his hopes that it was just a stray animal trapped under the house. But the next entry expressed his growing unease after thoroughly searching the property and finding nothing amiss. His writings perfectly mirrored my own escalating dread. I realized then that the cries plaguing me had roots much deeper than I knew. As I continued reading, a later journal entry described Grandpa searching the farm again early one morning and discovering, to his shock, an abandoned cot tucked away in a forgotten corner of the storm cellar, the same exact cot I had stumbled upon myself. Page after page revealed Grandpa's unsettled mind as the cries persisted over the years. He wrote of regretting that he didn't investigate further when it first started, before having a wife and family that he feared involving in the mystery. I could feel his frustration at leaving questions unanswered, burning through the aged pages. Closing the journal, I sat in contemplative silence. So Grandpa had experienced the same phenomena and was left tormented by a lack of resolution. I decided to camp out all night near the storm cellar to finally capture evidence of what caused them. I was done tossing and turning every night. It was time for answers. In the fading afternoon light, I lugged the old cot from the cellar up to ground level. I set it up facing the doors, just a few yards away. It wasn't the most comfortable stakeout spot, but it would do. That cot had waited down in the dark too long. It was going to finally help expose the source of those wails. Next, I packed supplies. Blankets, a pillow, water, and non-perishable snacks to last the night. I brought an arsenal of flashlights, candles, and lanterns too. Most importantly, I set up the motion-activated trail camera again, directly facing the cellar doors. Anything emerging tonight would be captured on film. As the sun dipped below the cornfields and the sky darkened, I settled onto the creaky cot, armed with my camera and light sources. The night breeze tickled my skin as I sat watching and waiting, determined to outlast whatever this night held. I glanced over at the farmhouse one last time, seeking courage from memories of Grandpa's strength. The first few hours ticked by uneventfully. The occasional cries still came up from the cellar, but nothing was visible yet. Fighting against boredom and nagging doubts, I passed the time sipping coffee and keeping my senses sharp. I sat ready to leap into action the second anything changed. The chill deepened as the night dragged on silently. Dew soaked through my socks and the cot mattress, but my mind stayed locked on the cellar doors. When the faintest glow of sunrise finally peaked above the trees, I was exhausted but alert. Just then, movement! A strange bluish light began emanating from the cracks between the cellar doors. I instantly grabbed the camera, snapping pics as fast as possible. The light intensified, like flickering firelight trying to escape. This was it. After all this time, something was finally emerging. I zoomed the lens, hoping for a clear shot of whatever being had made those cries. My hands shook as I gripped the trail camera, scrolling desperately through the photos to see what had emerged from the cellar. The first images showed only darkness, then a faint glow began to leak around the door edges. As each pic loaded, the light intensified until an amorphous blue shape started to rise through the cracks. It almost resembled a human form, but blurred and transparent. My heart pounded wildly in my chest. The undeniable proof was right here. I zoomed the image in, struggling to make out more details of the phantom-like shape. The ghostly form appeared feminine, with long, flowing hair trailing behind. The facial features were indistinguishable, but intense sorrow emanated from her fluid movements. Fumbling with the camera buttons, I hastily scrolled back to review the footage, again frame by frame. The being glided slowly upwards through the doors, as if floating on an ethereal current. As she fully emerged, hovering several feet off the ground, she raised her arms outward and her head tilted back. The light around her pulsed brighter for a moment, then began to recede back into the cellar depths, taking the apparition with it. I watched the chilling scene repeat several more times, affirming this was no trick of the light. Each replay only confirmed the unbelievable reality. A ghostly woman had actually emerged from Grandpa's storm cellar right before my eyes. After all these weeks of doubt and confusion, I finally had concrete evidence of the supernatural events plaguing this farm. With the sunrise spreading golden light and warmth across the yard, I set down the camera, feeling an odd sense of relief mixed with awe. So Grandpa's spirit wasn't restless after all, but perhaps this sad woman's was, haunting the property he too had once called home. Many mysteries still remained about her identity, her ties to this land, and why she lingered so many years later.